This week on Maker Update, snap-on goggles for your electric hair, easy-to-make wall plotter, big dragons, and better eyes. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome back to another Maker Update, the show where we update you on cool projects makers are making. I hope you're doing well and finding some inspiration in the new season. I've got a great show for you. Let's get started with the project of the week. On his YouTube channel, Zabarta shares how he made this updated LED-lit version of the Oakley Medusa helmet. This was actually a commissioned project from Oakley, whose original Medusa helmet design dates back to 2002. For this updated take, Zabartus is taking design cues from a purely digital concept design Oakley produced for an animated series. To bring it to life, he made this CAD model from scratch and fabricated most of the pieces using a semi-flexible 3D printed resin. There are a lot of techniques here he's applying from other helmet builds, such as layering 3D printed elements, concealing wires in the lining, and mixing textures and paint finishes for a more professional look. One of the most interesting aspects of his design, though, is the use of embedded neodymium magnets. Not only is he using these mechanically to attach and release the goggles and the ear cups, but he's also integrating them with the electronics. Each magnet is soldered to its own wire and then routed through the helmet. This way, when the goggles snap into the helmet, they trigger the LED animations. For each LED tube, he's using two strips of thin, LED-dense NeoPixel strip placed back-to-back to produce a glow all the way around. In total, there are over 1,600 LEDs with a potential draw of up to 115 watts if the brightness is not carefully limited in the code. To provide the power, there's a USB cable in the back that runs out to a power bank you can keep in your pocket or jacket. To eliminate the risk of the cable getting caught on something and damaging the helmet or your head, Zabarta shares a tip for using these magnetic breakaway USB cables. I believe they're made as more of a MagSafe style breakaway charger for your laptop or smartphone, but they really seem to be a useful solution for wearable electronics and cosplay projects where there's a risk of getting snagged on something. This is a super cool project. Congrats to Zabartus. You can check out the full build video using the link in the description. More projects. Nick Ivanov has launched a very well-documented, inexpensive, open-source wall plotter called Mural. The project uses a widely available bill of materials with no special parts or custom PCBs. It's just an ESP32 board, two stepper motors, some generic stepper drivers, a hobby servo to lift the pen, and some power management and a timing belt. The enclosure is 3D printed, the firmware is over on GitHub, and because it runs on an ESP32, you can send files to it wirelessly and control everything over your web browser or smartphone. If you've ever wanted to play around with a big wall plotter, this looks like a well thought out, inexpensive, and easy to accomplish project. For another project on a large scale, check out this giant articulating laser cut dragon being made by Laura Matthews. What I find so interesting about this project is that you get to really see how digitally designed projects like this can scale up dramatically. After getting the idea tested out in this desktop scale model, going big with it is really just a question of the machines you have access to and reinforcing the design to support the increased weight of the material. Now for some tips and tools. The evolution of Will Cogley's animatronic eye mechanisms have made many appearances on this show, not just from Will, but from other people's projects as well. Most recently, we saw them in the animatronic Pikachu from Kiara's workshop. This mechanism has become the gold standard for DIY animatronics, and now it's gotten even better. With version 3.2, Will has reduced the number of parts by using a design where many of the joints 3D print in place. This means less hardware and a better chance of getting things assembled correctly and quickly. Will has also announced his own dedicated servo control board based on the Raspberry Pi Pico, along with a line of realistic eyes which are compatible with his design. Like everything else here, I'll leave a link in the description where you can learn more. Over on MakeZine.com, Jen Schachter has a great resource for anyone trying to optimize their laser cut designs for short run production. Jen's been running her own business selling laser cut models for years now and has learned some valuable techniques for getting the most out of the popular Lightburn software. From job optimization to part labeling, custom fill settings, and design techniques, there's a lot of practical advice here to help you out. From the MIT CSAIL channel, there's a fascinating video on the applications of embedding strings into 3D prints to achieve cable-driven mechanisms and movements. It's a technique similar to embedding tool cloth for 3D printed fabric designs. Typically, you pause a print after the first few layers, introduce the element you want to embed, and then continue the print. But there are some great examples here where the technique is taken further. You can add channels so that the string moves and compresses the design. You can embed multiple strings to limit a range of motion or actuate the design in multiple directions. There's a lot to it, and this video serves as a great jumping off point. Finally, Stefan from CNC Kitchen has a helpful video on 3D printed organizers for your workshop. You've seen variations on this theme before, but Stefan's guide goes above and beyond for me with an extensive linked list of all the bins and hangers and organizers used in his video. Super useful. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, Zach, the bite-sized engineer, has a great project video out showing how he created his own portable solder fume extractor that pairs up perfectly with the iFixit FixHub portable soldering station. Not only is it a fun video, but it's also a great introduction to Adafruit's USB-C breakout board, which gives you all sorts of options for defining the type of power you want to pull over USB-C. Check it out. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Thanks again to Cria Ciencia for the use of their lab. They're an outstanding resource for childhood science education in Barcelona, and I'll leave a link where you can learn more down in the description. Thanks as always to DigiKey for making this show possible, and thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.